Welcome. The following video or audio are the study of the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse of the King James 1611 Bible. Our family welcomes you to our household Bible ministry time. You may watch and listen with us. Our goal has been from Genesis to the book of Revelation. Each chapter by chapter we try. And topical preaching and teaching aids you can find by searching different topics. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Come and appreciate the word of God for our spiritual growth, our development in the word of God by these lessons. Please feel welcome to upload and share our Bible study with family and friends. Like us, subscribe, write a comment, let us know you heard the message. The video or audio are not copyrighted and should be used and not abused. Thank you. First Thessalonians chapter 4. Furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus Christ, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk, and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. So, talking to the saved Christians, he says, we told you how to walk, how to please God. Do more and more. Never settle for the settled land. Keep going higher and higher when it comes to God. Do more each and every day. For ye know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. So there are commandments for Christians. There are things we're supposed to be doing. There are conducts. For this is the will of God. All right, what's the will of God? Even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication. Now this was a common practice in the land of Thessalonica, in their country, like Corinth. So don't be like the Thessalonians. Don't be like the other Europeans. Be separate. That every one of you should know how to possess his vessel. And that we learn from either 1st or 2nd Corinthians, that's our body. In sanctification and honor. Sanctification is set apart for God. I am going to stand against the world, and I'm going to stand for God. And honor God's ability to use you, that you're not filthy. God can call upon you. Not in the lust of concupiscence, which is lust, unlawful, or irregular desire of sexual pleasures, carnal. Even as the Gentiles, which know not God. So, don't be like the world. Don't be like your city people. Don't be like the Gentiles. Be different. Be holy. Be righteous. Be sanctified. That no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any manner. Don't deceive your Christian brethren. Don't cheat them. Don't lie to them. Treat them right and have proper business dealings. Paul had to write to the Corinthian church and say, hey, listen, you know, you're not even supposed to be taking each other to court. Just take the loss. And God will settle the matter. And you got to realize, when he's writing to the Christians, he's saying, listen, if you're going to defraud one another, not only you doing wrong, but you're going to have to give account to God. The same one that that God told Paul, said, hey, why persecute thou me? Your conduct to a Christian, even if you are a Christian, God takes it personally. And we are not only supposed to be clean and sober before the world, but we ought to be treating the brethren in the church right. It's sorry, and it's a true fact that there are Christian businessmen out there who defraud not only the world, but the Christians that they know. That's a poor testimony, and the Bible speaks against it. Because that the Lord is the avenger of all such. He'll get you. And realize the God in the Old Testament that sent an evil spirit upon King Saul, that sent an evil spirit, the prophets, to another king, I forget what his name was, to believe a lie, that same God said, okay, fine, you want to deceive people? I'll send you a spirit of deceiving. I'll let Satan have his way with you. And it'll be 10 times, if not 100 times, worse than what you've done. Remember, you reap what you sow. And you always get more than what you put out. So you're supposed to have proper business dealings. As we also have forewarned you and testified. So Paul, he speaks about the things he's already spoken to the churches. And this is something that he's gotten with these churches and talks. Say, listen, Paul has directed the Thessalonians, there's a proper Christian way to do business. I've taught you that. Now remember it. For God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. So, what is holiness? Holiness is not being unclean. Holiness is being clean. And there's only one way you can be clean is by the righteousness of Jesus Christ, to have your sins confessed and repentance of your sins. Anybody who just lives like the world, you're not holy, and you're not doing it right. You're not doing your calling by God. People speak about, oh, what's the will of God? What's the calling of my life? To be holy. Now, let me ask you a question. God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. Our calling of God is to be holy. Now, if we cannot be holy, then God's a liar, right? We can achieve holiness because God says that's what we're called to do. It's possible for a saved Christian to be holy. There it is. Problem is, to many of us, including myself, we become unclean. Too many times. We're more unclean. I am more unclean than I am holy. I'm sorry to say. For therefore, that despises not man, but God, who has also given unto us his Holy Spirit. So, despising is wrong. And the despisement is, if he's saying that God who's given us his Holy Spirit, the despising is another Christian who has the Holy Spirit. We're not supposed to despise each other. That's not right. It's not proper. But as touching brotherly love, so verse 8 is about other Christians. Brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. So God, who is love, already speaks to us without a man what love is. That love is Jesus Christ, who died and suffered for us when we were enemies, when we were blasphemous, when we spoke against God. And the love of God is he still performed what needed to be done. And that is our conduct to other Christians. They may not be likable. They may not be present dispensation. But you ever read the story about the stiff-necked people of Israel in the Old Testament? But how God never forsook them? Every once in a while, he needed a man like Moses, like the Lord Jesus Christ, to step in and say, hey, they're ours. Forgive them. And yet God is long-suffering, and he's not willing that any should perish. He wants us all as Christians to get together, but Christians are more so to get together with worldly people who don't love the Lord Jesus Christ, who are not saved, than they are your own saints, your own brethren. That's a sorry state. But brotherly love is something that comes from God. So when you do an act of charity for somebody, get off your high horse. You didn't do it. God did it. God showed you that love. Because you were of your father, Satan, who's a murderer, who's a liar. Now you are of God the Father, who is love. You can't know love unless you know God. And you didn't know God or love when you were lost. And indeed ye do it toward all the brethren which are in all Macedonia. So what a remarkable testimony of the Thessalonians. They do have the brotherly love and the charity, which we read in previous chapters. Paul's not rebuking them. He's just reminding them. You know what we need every once in a while? We need a reminder because we forget. We're so entangled with this world. This world so frustrates our life. The Lord's Supper is to remind us of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and that he's coming again. But we beseech you, brethren, that ye increase more and more. Do more and more. Hey, you got the right brotherly love. You got the right charity. But don't stop. Keep growing. Keep going. Keep adding. Keep adding. Keep adding. That's hard. In the flesh. And yet, in God, through Jesus Christ, we can do it. And this all lies about the holiness. It's unclean to not love. It's unclean to not show favor. It is unclean to have bad business practice. Paul is showing us what holiness is. He's showing us sins and what uncleanness is. And that ye study to be quiet. Well, the other study in the Bible is study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You know what you got to do? You got to study to be quiet because we want to flap these gums too much. We got to know when to say something and when not to say something. A prudent person is somebody, before he opens up his mouth, he weighs out what needs to be said. Is this proper? Or is this the time? And the Bible says you got to study to be quiet. Shut up. Preachers have a bad problem with that because we always got our mouths open. And we're going to fail. And we're going to misquote the scriptures. We're going to say the wrong word. We're going to have the wrong attitude. They're going to accuse us of being hatred, but we really out of love. We're just trying to get the word out. And to do your own business. Mind your own business. That's what that is. To be holy is to mind your own business. And to work with your own hands. Work. Labor. As we commanded you. So that's something Paul has taught. That ye may walk honestly. You're supposed to walk honest. Supposed to be no lying. No fairy tales. Toward them that are without. Lost people. Calling into work and saying you're sick and you're not sick, that's a lie. That's not honest. Somebody asks you how you're feeling. He says, okay. And you're not. That's lying. A lie is a lie. No matter what color or what you put on. Or a lie is a lie. Toward them that are without. Non-saved people. People who are not in the body of Christ. Don't you lie to them. You know what a lie to the world is? Just say this prayer. Or do this motion. Works, baptism, membership, whatever. Give money. Whatever it is. That's a lie. You're not supposed to be doing that. And you're not supposed to be doing business practices with lies to the world. You make Christ and Christians look bad. And they're not going to listen to us when we try reaching them. And that ye may have lack nothing. So, it looks like if you are honest, and I'm not preaching give God $10, he'll give you $10,000. But it looks like if you live honest, and you live sanctified, you live in holiness, and not uncleanness, God will give you what you need. He will supply your needs if you are doing what he tells you to do. Now, if you are doing what God has told you to do, God is obligated by his word that he has to take care of it. He tells employers, listen, that guy does an honest day's work. You've got to pay him. God, if I do what you tell me to do, something's coming. If I'm your son and I'm obeying you as I'm supposed to be obeying my father, then there's something coming. But I would not have you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be stupid. I don't want you to not know this. Paragraph. So we've gone from a holy, righteous, sanctified life, and we're going to go into the rapture. I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, talking to saved people, concerning them which are asleep. Okay. Maybe through Timothy or letters to Paul, the Thessalonians are having a little problem. What happened to what's going on? Or the question is, the dead people who have died in Christ, what's going on? What happens to them? And that's a question that hey, it happens. And you could be saved and reading your Bible and have a loved one pass on. And listen, I think about it, and Satan will mess with your mind. He'll try to put disbelief about that loved one. But let's jump down to verse 18 real quick. Notice verse 13, verse 18 in this chapter. Isn't that interesting? Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. What Paul's going to say about the Christian death is a comfort. And listen, yes, you're going to cry. Yes, you're going to miss that person. Yes, that person is now gone from the earth. But you can be comforted. I've got right now family in heaven. And it's a comfort. Because I'm going there too. I've got family that's in hell. I can't do anything about that no more. I'm never going to see them again. But for anybody who's saved in your family or your co-worker, whoever, Christian, if they are saved and die, you know they're better than you are. Because you got to, and I hate to use the word envy because I don't know any other word to use, but you got to think about it. They're no more pain. They're no more suffering. And there's sometimes I feel bad because my mom has MS and she's slowly dying, and I tell the Lord, take her home. And somebody in the world, that's more, asking your mom, yeah, but that's be the best thing to be right now. She's lived a full life. She's saved. She knows she's saved. She knows when she dies, she knows where she's going to go. If she were to die, I would miss it, and I'd be sorrowful, but the pain, the suffering, the falling down, and the bruises are gone. And he's talking to brethren. No unsaved person can have this. Concerning them which are asleep, the Bible says as far as death for a Christian, they're asleep. Because the Bible says that we've already read, absent from the body, present with the Lord. You know, ever wonder why? Now just think about this for a minute. Let's look at the Bible. I personally have been with setting up for a funeral and all that. Ever wonder why they put a pillow and padding in a coffin? You really think that body's going to feel anything? Yet the Bible says that body's asleep. So what do you do when you go to sleep? You put a pillow. They don't even know what they're doing, and yet they're following the Bible. Isn't that amazing? The world, are obeying the Bible, and they don't even know. They are asleep because they're absent from the body. The body, the flesh is sleeping. It's laying down. It's not active. And yet their soul is present with the Lord. They are in glory now. They have ended their faith. They have seen Jesus and are living presently with Jesus. Their body hasn't caught up. We're going to see what happens with the body. So concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not. And that's not, don't cry for a lost one. Because he says, even as others which have no hope. It's the sorrow of, oh, where are they going? Where are they? I don't know where they are. Oh, my life is miserable. No. That's the world. That's the lost person when somebody died. Oh, where'd they go? Whatever happened to them? I've got family. I don't know where they ended up. I think they're saved. I've got family. I'm pretty sure they're in hell. There was no hope for them. But the world looks at death and they wear black. Because it's a miserable time. Not for a Christian. It's a wonderful time. Somebody's going home. For if we believe that Jesus died. You believe that Jesus died? Okay. If we believe that Jesus died. Confidence. Even after death. And rose again. Now what is that? Anybody recognize what that is? You should have. With all the scriptures we've done so far. He died and rose again. Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures, was buried and rose again according to the scriptures. There's the gospel in death. That's what gives you life. Not eating Jesus, not church membership, not baptism, not saying a prayer. The gospel. He died and rose again. Do you believe that? Then guess what? Even so, them also that sleep in Jesus. Confidence. Will God bring with him? Future. 2 Corinthians 5:8. Again. We'll come back when we get down to that verse to bring it back. But Jesus will God bring with him. Jesus. That's him. Jesus. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. This I'm going to say. This is what God said. Okay? This is what God said. That we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord will not prevent them which are asleep. A concrete box is not going to stop them. Sealing that coffin by removing a vacuum and removing all the air and putting a lock on it is not going to stop it. Burning their bodies into ashes as torture or as even cremation. I mean, if you do cremation, if they've died and gone to be with the Lord saved, you're not going to stop what the Lord is going to do. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Get that important. Jesus shouts from the third heaven. Now, I'm going to say this to get you thinking. Because if you're saved, we may hear that shout. I don't want you to think, oh my God, we missed the rapture. There's two phrases to the rapture now. There's those that die and those that are alive. If you're alive, you may hear a shout before you hear the trumpet. I don't know if that shout's just for the dead. So when you read about John 11, do you think Jesus said, Lazarus, come out? Or do you think Jesus shouted it? I believe according to scripture, he shouted, Lazarus, come out! Because he's going to shout. With the voice of the archangel. That's Michael. And with the trump of God. Some people want Donald Trump. I want the trump of God. You can keep Donald Trump. Hey, I pray for his soul, but I'll take the trump of God over any day. And notice it does not say trumpet. You got to get that. God took off the ET, the trump of God. And the dead in Christ, go back to verse 14, which sleep in Christ, the dead in Christ. See the sleeping dead? When a Christian dies, he sleeps. To us, they're dead, shall rise first. So dead Christians will go first. I know, you know, they're 6 feet under, and I've heard all the things. Why? I don't know. I can't answer. I have no idea. Why the dead go first? Then we which are alive and remain shall... Okay, so we are living. The dead will go before us. Don't get scared if we see this and we hear the shout and we start seeing, if we see them popping out. I don't know if it's going to be physical. I don't know if those graves are going to be moving the dirt or not. I have no idea. But, hey, Christian, realize it's happening. Now, shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain. There is no time period between those two mentioned in the Bible. It doesn't say a minute. It doesn't say an hour. It doesn't say a day. It doesn't say, it has no time listed. This may have nothing to do with the reference. I'm going to say again, this may have nothing to do with the reference. This may have nothing to do with this reference. But when the dead in the Old Testament rose, when Jesus died on that cross, they were around for 40 days before Jesus ascended to heaven. Now, that may have nothing to do with this reference. But there's no time period between which they are asleep and caught up. For the Lord shall descend, and the dead in Christ shall raise first. Then we which are alive, there's no time frame. Is it instant? It can be. Is there a period of time? There can be. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. So the dead will rise. We will meet with those that have died. So there will be a resurrection. Paul will come out of the grave. These Thessalonians that are saved here are going to come out of the grave. We don't even know where they're all buried. God does. We may get raptured right now and meet in the clouds. Hey, how'd you guys like our book? I thought it was pretty good. What a great time to have a rapture when the Lord, we're studying the rapture. That we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. So we're going to meet in the clouds. That is the first heaven. From the earth as far as the eagle can fly, that's man's domain. Now, the rapture began with Christ in the third heaven, calling those that have died. We have now gone from the first heaven below the earth, and now we are all in the clouds, those who have died in Christ and those that are living still. Now we have a one church assembly where there are no unsaved people. We are all saved. We're meeting together in the church. So there will be one day when the church will gather and there'll be no world, no unsaved people ever. To meet the Lord in the air. Oh, look at that. He shouted from the third heaven. Now, when his bride is all together, he is there in the first heaven getting ready to meet it. So we go up to the clouds, we get together, and then the next stop we go, we see Jesus. And so shall we ever, ever be with the Lord. How can you not say, can I lose it? From that point on, you will never leave the Lord Jesus Christ. That is eternal security right there. Forever and ever. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Christian is involved with death. Christian has lost assurance. Now, because it's kind of funny, because over here, see if I can find it real quick. We've already looked at with the Thessalonians. But in chapter 1, verse 10, and to wait for his son from heaven, there's a rapture. We've already studied it, went through it. They actually had the assurance of their, I don't know. Hmm. But it's we've already looked at it. Go back and we studied through the. But the assurance. Somebody is having a lack of assurance. What can help them? Chapter 4 of the 1 Thessalonians. What can happen if a Christian is dying and someone's upset? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It says, wherefore comfort one another with you. Oh, I am just so fed up with this world. I'm just about to give up. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4.
In chapter 2, verse 19.
2:19.
The second part of it. Are not even ye in the presence of the Lord?
And that's the rapture. There's the rapture again. And
that's chapter 3, verse 13. At the coming of
our Lord. At the coming of our Lord. There's a rapture again. So see, it's fluid. What did the Thessalonians have their eyes on? They had their eyes on Jesus coming. And you know what? It didn't happen. But the day it does happen, when God calls you, you guarantee you're going to be hooping for joy.
Get to see him
first. Well, no, actually, we're going to see them all together. They're going to go to the clouds, then those that are alive will meet with them. We'll see each other first. Then we go get to see Jesus. As one, nobody will see Jesus first. Be all together at one point in time. And like I said, I don't know if this is a weird doctrine. I hope it's not. That there is no time frame between the dead in Christ that go and then when we go. And it's almost like if God is like, give us an opportunity to witness even more. I don't know. I'm not going to say that. Because it may be as soon as they go, we go. But what a lively hope that, hey, they've got down in Orlando, Florida, they got stores set up for the zombie apocalypse. And they don't realize that zombie apocalypse is the fact is we're not going after brains. We're going to come out of the grave and go for Jesus. There is going to be a big resurrection they're afraid of. But there's no way to fear because we're gone. Matter of fact, a lot of them will be happy. Because, hey, those Christians are gone. But for us, and here, let's see. We shall be caught together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord. Now, when we meet the Lord, faith is done. The only faith we got left after this, crowns. Because we haven't been judged yet. The only faith we got left after that is New Jerusalem. But as far as faith in Jesus Christ, it's done. Because there he is. When we see Jesus, there'll be no more faith about rapture, which just happened. There'll be no more faith when I get to see Jesus. There he is. And that begins your eternal life. No more pain. Can't say sorrow, because there'll be tears in Revelation 20, the great white throne. But after that, the tears are wiped away, and there's no more sin. And I read the other day a Christian said, oh, no, not now. You're a fool. You're a fool. It will never happen. If God would come to me and he said, I'll give you anything you want, like Solomon. He gave Solomon a blank check. If God ever came to me like that, you better believe we're going to be in the clouds. What about your lost family? I witnessed to him. What about your job? I don't care about no job. What about your I don't care about my foot. I want to be with Jesus. Well, what about the people at the farmer's market? I've been preaching to them I don't know how long. If God would give me a blank check, it'd be one thing. Go with the Trump. And I don't mean Donald. I gotta say that today.